Thank you for thinking about Your Education Matters. Dr. Kanwal Neal is an internationally recognized mathematics educator with diverse experiences. He was a classroom teacher in Richmond for over 30 years. He is a keynote and workshop presenter. Kanwal also is a software developer, consultant, researcher, teacher educator, and host to the award-winning television series Math Shop. Dr. Neal is one of the authors of the Pearson Mathematics Makes Sense textbook series. He has been a mentor to many recertifying teachers new to Canada through SFU's professional qualification program. Kanwal is currently serving as Associate Director in Professional Programs in the Faculty of Education at Simon Fraser University. Kanwal Neal has contributed countless hours over the last 40 years as an official in track and field from local to international events. He volunteers tirelessly in the community in different roles, such as that of a mentor to our budding teachers and young adults. In his spare time, he enjoys spending time with his family and traveling around the world. We are pleased to welcome Dr. Kanwal Neal to Your Education Matters. Like to start our discussion today by asking you to give us something of your biography, because it's not what it appears. For example, I know from knowing you that you've never lived in India.
That's for sure. And it's one of those myths that people have by just observing you. So my parents are from Indian origin, and they moved to Kenya, and I was born and raised in Kenya and migrated to Canada in 1969. So I did my high school and university education at University of British Columbia. And so once I graduated from UBC, and my first teaching job was in Richmond, school district number 38. And like many beginning teachers, it was the first year was one of those roughest years. You know, you have seven different teaching blocks, you have large classes, and you do all those things. And it was a wonderful start. And track and field is what I competed in at university. So I was the track coach, and I've done coaching and officiated in track and field over many, many years. Mathematics and computer science were the subjects I started teaching with. And in a couple of years, the first set of Apples came into the school. So I was there when the Apple II and the Apple IIe, and now, of course, we're up to the iPads, were in the school. So I was there to start with. And it was a great journey to see how technology has changed over the years. So early years, you kind of get a sense of, you know, what do you want to do as in your career? And you start attending conferences, you start meeting others, and then you realize, you know what, I need to shift my thinking and my way of being somehow. And in my mid-years, I had the opportunity of becoming a faculty associate at Simon Fraser University. So I call that the mid-years of my teaching career. So 1989 to 91, I was seconded for 2 years, and we can talk more about that later. And when I returned to the classroom, that was one of my toughest years. And it was very difficult because you had learned so much and you have changed so much, and you now have that professional courage to move on, but some of your colleagues aren't. So I shifted, I changed, and it was a totally different way of being. So in the middle years, and then in a couple of years after that, I had an opportunity to co-host the television series Math Shop. And this show was basically teaching math to students who hadn't been successful in mathematics, and also for adult learners who are having difficult time to graduate. Because as you know, in many cases, math becomes the gatekeeper course. You couldn't get your diploma, your high school diploma, until you got the math. So one thing led to another, and we made 16 half-hour shows. And the show was syndicated across Canada, so it was a wonderful opportunity to see many people who had the opportunity to see that show. So it was a wonderful opportunity, and at that time, I also started doing some work for some software developer. Nelson did the learning equation, and then later on, I also worked with Pearson Education when they were doing the Mathematics Makes Sense the textbook series. I also consider towards the end of my middle years is when I got involved in the BC Association of Mathematics Teachers. So in 1999 to 2001, I was the president of the BC Math Teachers Association. It gave me an opportunity to see what is happening across Canada, also going to some of the remote communities in British Columbia and seeing how poorly some of our Aboriginal students were doing, and gave me that thinking that, you know what, something needs to happen and needs to be done. So that was another one of my ways of giving back to the community. Is a few years later, in 2002, I enrolled in my doctoral studies, and in 2008, and now those would be my later years or years with experience, is I did my research in Haida Gwaii and looked at numeracy, connecting community, pedagogy, and epistemology, and looking at how we can shift our thinking, our teaching, our way of knowing, and how can we help the Aboriginal students, and for that matter, all students, do better in mathematics and in other content areas too.
Who did you study with for your PhD?
I studied with Dr. Peter Lilidell, and it was a very interesting. Dr. Lilidell had just finished his doctorate a couple of years ago, and you know we would be learning from each other. And then, of course, Dr. Mark Fettis, who is also doing a lot of work in imaginative education. And then Vonnie Hutchinson, who was the director of Haida Education. And of course, I was mentored by many of the elders in the Haida community.
To my knowledge, the only other university in North America that uses a design like this is York, which is emulating SFU, because one of our faculty went out there and started their program.
Yes.
And although it's the only way SFU has ever done teacher education, I think it's too little on people's radar, the
True.
Uniqueness of this design and the power
yes.
of seconding this cadre. It's about 50.
Yes.
50 master teachers
yes.
to come. People who are absolutely current and effective in today's classrooms mm-hmm. with today's students to mm-hmm. play a key role in mentoring the next generation of teachers. Now, just to contrast, other
sure.
universities that I've worked at five or six before I
yes.
came here typically either use faculty themselves
yes.
to do these roles,
yes.
or they use graduate students.
Right.
That's how I worked my way
yeah.
through graduate school. Or they use retired people,
right.
teachers, or other persons who have taught but are not currently teaching.
Right.
So those are all different models, and they have their strengths and weaknesses. But the SFU model is particularly powerful because the faculty associates are people who can work with today's students, and they've mastered the problems that they're facing in schools today.
You're absolutely right. And something else that you mentioned, Paul, is many teachers are looking for what else can I do to better myself, to be a better professional. And as you know, some of them think that going into administration is the end pathway, but here is a wonderful opportunity to get into curriculum, instruction, professional development. So what happens with many of our faculty associates once they leave us, I would say only about a third of them go into administration. Two-thirds of them would return to the classroom, but they take leadership roles in the district.
Yes.
Leadership role in terms of, you know, working with students now back as school associates, or they might work with parents, or they might work with other community resources
yes,
too.
So
it's a wonderful way.
It reinvigorates our teacher
corps sure
along the way and opens doors like the possibility for you to work on
mm-hmm.
your doctorate.
Yeah.
The PQP program, I'd like you to describe for folks. There's some people out there watching that I'm sure would be candidates for.
For sure, yes. So about 10 years ago, you know, we were seeing that there are a number of recent immigrants who are fully qualified and they want to recertify themselves and teach in British Columbia. So our PQP professional qualification program came to being, and it's a year-long program, again three semester, but the unique piece is the first semester we spent a lot of time in building the enculturation. So getting them to see what the culture is, what the school culture here is, but we also want to honor, and we also want to capitalize on their resources and their expertise. So in the first semester, there's a course on reflective practice that they will do. And in the second semester, they do the visitation of schools, school experience, community experience, and as a requirement for the BC College of Teachers, they will be also doing their long practicum in the third semester. The PQP is unique because we know that many people coming from all over the world, some of them have accents, but their clarity of instruction, their clarity of understanding is so deep that we have found that, you know what, within a couple of days, the students understand them and the parents, you know, totally enjoy their expertise in their classrooms.
There are some people, however, who can never bridge the cultural gap. I know from doing my job at SFU.
Yes.
It does help some people to realize that their notion of being a teacher isn't going to work in British Columbia, that they come from
and you know what,
very
Paul,
different place.
That's for sure. And that's even true for some of our graduates from British Columbia too. You know, I know many of them have their lifelong dream to be a teacher, but you know, once they get into the classroom, it's not just taking a course, but it's those relationships with those children. It's those way of connecting with the children, understanding the pedagogy, knowing the content and teaching is sometimes two different things.
It's
and
very,
some of them find it a challenge.
Culturally sensitive
for
work.
Sure. Yes.
And we'll come back to that
okay.
in the second part of our program.
Sure.
Thank you. We'll be back in a moment.
I'm ready. I want the adventure. I saw an SFU presentation back in my high school in Italy, and after a lot of research, I decided to enroll in the mechatronics program. You know what? 3 years later, here I am working on my robots. Being in a cohort program such as Stegman was a great opportunity to make friends, and some of those friendships are still lasting nowadays. I think it's really important to try things out before you actually commit to them. And my co-op experience really helped me decide what I was going to do in life. SFU is not only a place where you learn, but also a place where you can share ideas and really grow as an individual. In my first year, I was looking for clubs at SFU, and I found Engineers Without Borders. It really changed my perspective on things, and after that, I also ended up changing my major. So now I'm in my third year in engineering physics, and after taking a TA position, I really discovered a love for teaching. What I want in my life is really more than just work. I want to take on some projects in Latin America. I want to travel. And I definitely see teaching in my future, a complete life.
Canwal, in addition to the PQP,
yes.
where we work with international persons who have come to Canada,
yes.
I'd like you to describe how we take Canadians all over the world to help them become teachers.
For sure. So we have modules that go to four different places around the world. We call them the ITEM International Teacher Education Module. We have had a group of students that go to Oaxaca, Mexico. We used to have a group that went to Trinidad also. We have a group that goes to China, Xi'an right now. We also have a group that goes to Mali in Africa. And also 2 years ago, we started having a group going to Dharamsala in India. The India one was unique because they work with the Tibetan refugees that are living in India. So now they get the opportunity of doing community engagement, service learning, and at the same time, learning about teaching and learning. And uniqueness is that they learn from the teachers that are there, then they come back and they get to practice in the schools of British Columbia too.
And your own daughter is an international teacher.
Well, right? She is. She graduated from PDP and she's teaching in an international school in Bangkok at the moment.
And you told me the BC curriculum, right?
And it's a BC international school, so she's teaching the BC curriculum and you know what, best of both worlds.
So again, we'd like our audience to know what an international career teaching can be and the opportunities that are there.
That's exactly it. You know, as you know that, you know, the job market fluctuates. So our graduates have the opportunity of basically teaching around the world.
And the job market's very healthy for French immersion.
Oh, that's the other piece. Yes. Well, French immersion and the other piece is we also now have a PLP, Professional Linking Program, which enables people who are special education assistants or education assistants who want to become teachers. And they can do it on a part-time basis, and then they do a practicum and become teachers in the school districts.
Okay. Yeah. Now, I want to pick up a thread we began before in talking about your career, who you are, where you taught, and where you did your doctoral research. You've been exposed to a great deal of the different cultures
yes.
of British Columbia.
Yes.
And I'd like you to talk about culturally sensitive teaching.
Yes.
What you've learned and what you help people to understand about how to work with all these different groups.
Wow. So the whole notion of, you know, culturally responsive curriculum and culturally, you know, sensitive way of teaching, I started looking at this a number of years ago, as I told you, when I was the president of the BC Math Teachers Association. And from there, the opportunity came, and I would start with my grade 9 classes, is I'd do a project where the students would choose an artifact from their culture, and then we looked at the embedded mathematics based on it. I'll give you an example, folding origami, or looking at even pizza. And when you look at pizza, is people think, what can you do with mathematics? It, some would do very simply looking at the area and the volume, and I had grade 12 students looking at the combinations of the different toppings you can do. So it became very relevant for them. You know, food is always great for students. Then we would look at First Nations artifacts, totem poles. Mm-hmm. When you look at totem poles, there is deep-rooted intuitive geometry that takes place, you know, looking at scaling, looking at, you know, how the different pieces are connected, how the legends are connected with the carving. Then you look at the environmental issues. Most recently, I've had the students design, they would do a refugee camp, or recently they've designed a camp. An earthquake has struck Haiti, and you are given so many dollars. So now it becomes not only culturally sensitive, but it becomes mathematically infused in some of the problem-solving ideas that you need to do. So when I was doing my research in Haida Gwaii, I would meet many carvers, I would meet many jewelry makers, and I would ask them, so how do you use mathematics? And they'd say, we never use mathematics. And then the next question I ask is, tell me a little bit about your carving. And you know what, I'd be amazed. They have such deep-rooted ideas about tessellations, about translations, about rotation, symmetry. Those are some of the things we teach in grade 9. So my thinking is, if we can start from what the community knows and then bridge it with the curriculum we teach, then those students feel empowered. They feel that their curriculum, their way of knowing is acknowledged, is becoming part of who we are as a society. And I think that's the key to shifting our pedagogy. And as I started looking at becoming one of the authors in Mathematics Makes Sense, that's what we started to look at. How do we shift from that way of being where, you know, you do last day's homework, here is the new stuff, here is tomorrow's homework, and you break that cycle. So that cycle shifted by looking at exploring or investigating. You can start simply by investigating a piece of art and looking at the mathematics from there. Or you look at a piece of drawing or a piece of architecture. And from there, then you connect with the learning that is going to happen. You connect with the concepts. It could be area, it could be perimeter, or it could be simple algebra, looking at maximizing volume. I mean, I do the maximizing volume by looking at a bentwood box. So the bentwood boxes are used by First Nations communities, and basically that's what they did. You maximize the volume, but you maintain the same amount of materials. Mm-hmm. So you want to sustain the material, and you want that particular piece to be. So this can be used from kindergarten all the way to university calculus courses. But then it's centered around culture, and it's centered around artifacts, which are so akin to a community. Most recently, and we have a calendar, Mathematics and Culture, we did some work with the Squamish Lillooet Nation. And again, looking at the artifacts from that community, weaving blankets. You know, weaving blankets is, again, a phenomenal way of looking at patterns and geometry. Rather than teaching them in an abstract way, now the context is from that particular community. And then we also looked at, and it happened in 2009, we were hosting the Northwest Mathematics Conference, and we did a session called Mathematics and Sports. So we did a behind the scenes at the sliding center, where the luge and the other events happened for the Olympics. So looking at all the curves and things, so it became a wonderful piece of integrating algebra, integrating geometry, and integrating problem solving and physics by looking at sports and mathematics. So those are ways of, you know, getting the students really enthused and interested about a content area.
Well, those are remarkable examples, and I'm glad we touched on something that's obviously a passion for you, mm-hmm. so that the audience could share why those of us that are in education like to be in education.
That's right.
We like to get excited about
That's
things
right.
like this, and we know it can make a difference in people's lives. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm wondering about functionally, how can you translate that in school districts that have hundreds and thousands of students and classrooms that have dozens of students? How can a teacher have the energy and ability to amplify themselves into the experience of each one of these students? It might have quite a few different sets of needs.
It is, it is. It's really interesting. And I think one of the biggest things is you've got to look at having a professional learning community. I think what happens is teachers get so isolated and they feel so discouraged because of the multitude of issues, problems that are around them. One of the things that I found is if teachers teach together as a team, and I've had some success with that, is what we call a lesson study model. Is you get to work with a number of colleagues, and one teacher would teach and others would observe, and you could focus it on teaching, again, like I said, culturally responsive material. I've done it with tangrams, I've done it with other ideas which are, you know, different cultural ideas, but then you connected with the mathematics. Then you kind of brainstorm and say, what are some of the current pedagogical ideas that can be combined with the curriculum content? Once that happens, then the teachers buy in because this becomes something that they have developed. I think what happens is a lot of the time, when you have experts coming and talking to groups, is it only stays at the expert level, it'll stay a little bit. But if you have the learning community where teachers now buy in, they feel that this is their curriculum, then shift starts to happen.
Well, you're putting your finger right on an example of a reform that those of us that care about British Columbian education would like to see happening. Mm-hmm. And there's some degree of frustration because too much of our energy gets leached off in other directions.
That's true.
And in political partisan debates.
Yes.
And that type of thing. When there are some obvious things like the professional learning communities and breaking down the walls between classrooms and teachers,
yeah,
that offer tremendous promise.
That's for sure.
The model you describe, I became acquainted with from reading about it in the book, The Teaching Gap, and it was from Japan.
That's right.
So
that's right.
We kind of bring things full circle.
Exactly.
We're not only trying to educate other groups,
yeah,
of people, but they educate us.
That's right. And in The Teaching Gap, they talk about teaching being a cultural activity. And that cultural activity is so important. And last year I was in Australia, and one of the Aboriginal researchers talks about research is about people, places, and perspectives. And it's that people, the relationship piece is always very central. And different places have different contexts, be it an Aboriginal community or teaching those Chinese students in Richmond or working in different places. And the perspectives, and being at the university or the schools, they're different perspectives. But how do we make those perspectives align so that we have the best for the students that we teach?
Well, as a concrete example, you've brought this drum. So could you tell us what this
drum
has to do with
teaching? So the drum has to, the teaching, I drew the maple leaf. That's, we're grounded in Canada, the maple leaf. And I kind of drew different numerals from different cultures. So it is, as you can see, the 12, and it's like a clock. And what I call this is, it's about time. It's about time that the heartbeat of every classroom should be those relationships and the rhythm. It's the rhythm that we take within our classes, within our homes, within our communities, should have that rhythm of a heartbeat where we connect with each other, and the time is now. The time is now to connect with everything.
Well, that's very encouraging, Kanwal. I so much appreciate you coming and sharing these things, your ideas about education and your experiences with our audience, because you're another great example of the excellent people we have in education in British Columbia.
Thank you so much. Thank
you
so much.
And the opportunities that persons like yourself have had to grow in,
right,
their career,
yeah,
and to fully realize themselves.
I appreciate that. Thank you kindly.
Yes. Thank you. We'll be back in a moment. Slowly, the action in education reform is drifting away from the testing and accountability movement toward the improvement of instruction. This is an overdue response to the great omission of the accountability movement, what to do to improve teaching once the testing results are in. Accountability advocates have continually suggested that once we have a detailed paper trail of student learning weaknesses, magically teachers will be able to correct these deficiencies. Their implication is that the flaw in schooling is not knowing where the deficiencies lie. Teachers have typically had another point of view. Teachers and other educators have argued first for addressing the deficiency needs of children, that is, the effects of poverty and health and social problems. Next, when we have a child in school and ready to learn, educators ask for a setting with adequate human resources to address the size and special needs of their classrooms. Special needs must be recognized as demanding intensive instructional services. At this point, diagnostic and formative testing has a significant role, but only if accompanied by professional development of teachers' instructional skills. And this leads us back to the Great Awakening taking place in today's K-12 schools. Researchers, foundations, and government are joining teachers and school districts to work on improving instruction through new means of professional development and professional organization. High-stakes testing without the provision of renewal programming has wasted resources and frustrated those who care about our students. Fortunately, that movement is being surpassed. Thank you for thinking about Your Education Matters.